standing, Southpoint. Come on, stand to your feet. It's time to worship Jesus. Come on.
Do you see what I see?
Come on, clap your hands.
Do you see what I see?
Here we go.
Oh, I see lightning, I hear thunder. Something stirring 6 feet under.
Come on.
Dead things coming back to life again. I believe there's about to be another resurrection.
Hey.
Oh, I see signs and I see wonders. Burst the living color.
Dead things coming back.
Dead things coming back
to life again. I believe there's about to be another resurrection.
Come on, sing it out.
Come alive. Wake up, sleeper. He is risen. We are.
If you believe that this morning, sing out. Come on, come on.
If you see what I see, that the grave is empty, then you know what I know. Anything is possible. If you see what I see, that the grave is empty, then you know what I know. Anything. Do you see what I see?
Hey, hey,
do you see what I see?
Sing that again, sing it again.
Do you see what I see?
Oh, I see signs and I see wonders.
Do you see what I see?
I see lightning, I hear thunder.
Do you see what I see?
Light till from heaven you came running there was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Oh, we love you, Jesus. We praise you. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings.
You're so worthy, worthy, yeah.
and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus.
Holy are you, God.
Holy are you, God.
Holy
worthy, Jesus. You are worthy of all praise. Worthy of all honor. Worthy of all glory. There's no king who has lowered himself, who emptied himself like you. You became just like us, without sin, taking on our sin. Thank you, Jesus, for your death, your burial, and your resurrection. Because in you, we have newness of life. We have fullness of life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that you are exalted in this place. Thank you that you are exalted in our praises. Thank you that you are being exalted in this city as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. God is good, isn't he? Praise God. Well, welcome to Southpoint Community Church. You guys can have a seat. God is doing incredible things here at Southpoint Community Church. I want to take a moment to brag on your generosity. Last week, we took an offering for hurricane relief for those suffering from what the hurricane did in Georgia and North Carolina. And you guys gave almost $20,000. So praise God. Give yourselves a hand. That is letting God use your boat, like I talked about a couple of weeks ago. And then there was a group of men that went up to Augusta, Georgia. We got to give a huge offering to Augusta, Georgia. And we've already given them $12,000. We're going to give them the rest if we don't find other places to give the rest of the $20,000. But a team was led by Alex Mundell, and Derek Farrow helped him. And this team, I just want to brag on this team. They met here at 4 a.m. on Friday morning, filled with faith. They got in their vans, packed up, loaded up with all their chainsaws, the rig, all the stuff. They had it all loaded up, and they drove to Augusta, Georgia, and they were supposed to do three projects, but they ended up doing them so well and so efficiently that they did six projects. So the first project that they did is one guy came and he was quoted in a lower income neighborhood. He was pretty poor. The tree company quoted him $40,000 to remove all the damage from his property. And this was devastating. This would have really destroyed them. Well, they cleared it out. They did all that work in a day and a half. That was one of the projects. Another one of the projects is one guy had 10 plus massive pine trees down in his property. He couldn't even get into his house. It was covering his driveway. They cleared that all out in a day and a half. Come on, guys. This is incredible. They also saved a local business that was not going to be able to open up for several weeks. They cleared it all up so that he was able to open his business. And they were also able to help a guy who the tree fell on the house, destroyed the roof. So they cleared it all out, and then they gave him the money to be able to buy all the lumber to repair the roof. And this guy said about the Brazilians, there was a group of guys that Felipe brought. You know, Felipe is a man full of joy at all times. And so Felipe brought these guys, and these guys were commenting on the joy of these Brazilian workers, how they had so much love. And what Alex reported back to us was, man, these guys on this trip from South Point Community Church were full of love and compassion. They had incredible attitudes the entire time, barely sleeping, working all day long, giving their Friday and Saturday to Jesus. God is good. They helped the church in Augusta, who's been working for weeks. They've been, since the hurricane, they've been working nonstop to help the community, and they set an example for our team. God is good that we get to help a local family, our local church in our region reach their city by serving and giving their lives so that the gospel of Jesus can shine. Amen.
I told my children, I said, we have the best church in Jacksonville, Florida. I told them that on the way to church. And you know, there's amazing churches here, but there's not a better church than Southpoint Community Church. And you know why I can say that? Because it's our church. It's my family. I told my kids, I was like tearing up when Alex sent me all this stuff. I was like, this is just a beautiful family. And I'm so proud of my spiritual family. I know there's other churches with incredible speakers and incredible worship, and they're incredible. But because this is my family, it's the best family. Amen. All right, well, let's talk today about the kingdom. Let's go ahead and jump into this. We're going to start Matthew 3 in Jesus' baptism. And we're going to talk about Jesus' baptism in the weeks to come, but we're going to briefly talk about it tonight, today. And then we're going to look at chapter 4, the temptation of Jesus. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to John to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, I need to be baptized by you. And do you come to me? But Jesus answered him, let it be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he consented. And when Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him. And behold, a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son, with whom I'm well pleased. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread. But he answered, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, again, it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their glory. And he said to him, all these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. Then Jesus said to him, be gone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and were ministering to him. Father God, I thank you for your word. I thank you that your word is life. And Lord God, I thank you that you are helping us. Lord, I pray for every one of us that goes through the test, that goes through the trial, that we would overcome because you've called us more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. Lord, help us to be winners. Help us to overcome today. Glorify your Son in Jesus' name. Amen. Notice here in these verses a contrast. So Jesus is at the baptism, and there's water, there's a voice from heaven, there's the affirmation and the love of the Father, there's the confirmation that Jesus is the Son of God. He's pleasing to the Father. And then immediately in Matthew 4, it goes into a desert, the opposite of water, and then a voice from hell and an accusation and trying to disprove Jesus to be the Son of God. So what we see here is this great contrast, and we see Jesus being affirmed because he is pleasing to the Father. He's filled with the Holy Spirit. He's living a life of obedience, and then immediately we see a test. Jesus is being tested. Here it says that the Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness to be tempted. This word tempted in the Greek also means tested. And so what the point is here is this. If you are serving God, if you are pleasing to God, if you are living a life filled with the Holy Spirit, led by the Holy Spirit, and you are obeying God's commands, you will be tested. There's sometimes when we go through a trial because we're stupid. Amen. Some of the spouses lifted up their hands for their spouse. Sometimes we do stupid things and we deserve the trials that we go through. We make poor decisions. But there are times in the kingdom of God when you are pleasing to God and you are living a life filled with the Holy Spirit, led by the Spirit and empowered by the Spirit. And because you're living this life, God is going to put you to the test. He's going to let you walk through the fire. It says the Holy Spirit led, Jesus was led by the Spirit of God into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil, to be tested by the devil. There are three things that you need to know about the test. First, the test has two sides. On one side is God. God is testing you. God was testing Jesus to prove who Jesus was. There's a test, and he is on that side of the test. He's the one that initiates the test. But on the other side, Satan shows up, and there's the tempter. On the test, Satan takes that opportunity, and he shows up to come to destroy. God comes to prove who you are. Satan comes to disprove who you are. The second thing that we know about the test is this. The test is not an obstacle, but an opportunity. A lot of times when we look at tests that we face, whether it's a test that we're taking on paper or a workout test that we're doing, we think it is an obstacle. Oh my goodness, I can't believe I have to do this. But the test for God is an opportunity. And the test for the one that is following Jesus, that is pleasing to God like Jesus is, the test for them is not an obstacle. It is an opportunity. And what is the opportunity? The opportunity is for you to prove who God says you are. Right? God said to Jesus, this is my beloved son. With him, I'm well pleased. This is someone living a life pleasing to me. They are my child. They are my son. They are my daughter. The test is for you to prove who God says you are. It's an opportunity for you to prove your love for God, for you to prove your faithfulness to God, but it's also an opportunity for God to prove his faithfulness to you. Israel was led into the wilderness immediately coming out of Egypt. They were led into a place with no water and no food. It was a test by God so that they could prove their love for God. They could prove their belief in the one that saved them. And so that God could also prove his provision for their lives. When Adam and Eve were tested in the Garden of Eden with the knowledge of the tree of good and evil, it was an opportunity for them to prove their love and faithfulness to their creator who created them. It was also an opportunity for God to prove his provision for them. You may eat fruit from any tree in this garden. The test is an opportunity for you to prove who God says you are and for God to prove his love and his faithfulness for you. What do you see your test as today? Do you see it as an obstacle? Do you say, oh no, I can't believe I'm struggling in this way. I can't believe my marriage is the way that it is. I can't believe my finances are the way they are. I can't believe that my relationships in my life are the way they are. I can't believe my health is the way it is. Is it an obstacle to you? Or maybe an opportunity for you to prove your love and your faithfulness and who you are as a son or daughter of God. God loves the test for us. It's hard. But it's an opportunity. Thirdly, the test doesn't come as a means for salvation. And this is important that you understand this. The test is not so that we will be saved. It comes because we have been saved. The test is not a means for salvation. It is because of salvation. And it is a way for God to prove your salvation and for you to prove your salvation in the middle of the test. So if you are loved by God and if you are living a life pleasing to God, then you are going to be tested. Some of you are going through a test right now. God is going to help you. So the question is not, will you be tested? The question is, will you pass the test when the test comes? Will you pass the test? How many of you want to pass the test? I want to live a life, please. I want to get through the test. I want to win for Jesus. The answer is the victory's in Jesus. Amen. We see this in this passage. Matthew tells us exactly how Jesus passed the test. Now, to help us to understand how Jesus passed this test, we have to understand exactly what was the test that Jesus had to pass. Now, in the baptism, the Spirit of God, notice here, the Spirit of God descended upon Jesus. This is what Matthew tells us. And then there was a voice from heaven saying, "You are my son." This is Luke's and Mark's account. "With you, I am well pleased." Or in Matthew, "This is my beloved son. With him, I'm well pleased." Luke and Mark say, "This, you are my son. With you, I'm well pleased." Well, "You are my son" comes from Psalm chapter 2. If you read Psalm chapter 2, it's a messianic psalm. It's about the king and the son of God. And the son of God, it describes God's son as a ruler who would dash the nations to pieces with an iron scepter. And the psalm calls us to put refuge, put our lives into him, find refuge in him so that we won't be destroyed. So the Jews, when they heard this, "You are my beloved son," when they heard this, they were seeing a king who would destroy their enemies. A king who would destroy the occupation of Rome, who would remove Rome's oppression, who would remove the slavery and the oppression, the taxation, all the things that Rome was doing to the Jews. So they were hoping for this mighty king to come with a mighty scepter to just take out all their enemies. But the second part of this verse says, "With you I am well pleased." And that comes from Isaiah 42. And this is when God begins to talk about someone called the suffering servant. And I'm going to read you a little bit to help us to understand, so that we'll understand exactly what Jesus is being tested, how he's being tested. It says in Isaiah 42, "I've put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry aloud or lift up his voice or make it heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a faintly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice." He goes on in Isaiah 53. He says, he's talking about this suffering servant. "He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. But he was pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace." So this king, this suffering servant, Jesus, is this person who is humble, lowly, weak, and a suffering servant from men, from a person who men hide their faces, a man well acquainted with grief, who is despised by people, pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities, and the punishment that brought us peace was laid upon him. So the king that Israel had in their mind, coupled with this suffering servant, it didn't make sense. How could God's son, the messianic king, be someone who suffers and be a servant? This is who God declared his son to be. Mighty, strong, holding an iron scepter that can dash the nations. But lowly and humble, giving his own life, lowering himself, emptying himself to save the nations so that the nations could find refuge in him and not be destroyed by his justice and his might. So think about the temptation. If you are the Son of God, remember, this is the Lord, the Father said, you are my Son. With you, I am well pleased. If you are the Son of God, then command these loaves or these stones to become loaves of bread. In other words, what Satan is doing, he's saying, use your power. Come out of the place of service. Get out of the place of hunger. Get out of the place of need. Get out of the place of starvation. Use your power. Elevate yourself and be the Son of God if you really are. Do you see how the temptation is working? Then he takes him to the pinnacle of the temple. He goes from a low ground to a high ground, and he says, throw yourself off of this temple, and his angels will save you. Satan is trying to get Jesus to use his power. He's trying to get him to go from a place of a suffering servant to a servant where others serve him, to a king where others serve him. He's throwing the scriptures at him, saying, you should be high, you should be lifted up, you should be exalted. And at the end of the temptations, Satan comes to him and he takes him to a very high mountain. Look at the elevation, look at the change. Go from this low place to a high place, and you don't have to suffer. You don't have to give your life. You don't have to be a suffering servant. All you have to do is bow down to me and I'll give it all to you. Jesus overwhelmingly passed the test. You know why? Because he stayed the Son of God, who was a suffering servant, and he laid down his life. Do you realize if Jesus would have given in to any one of these lies of Satan, he would not have been able to be our Savior? Because he would have gone from a suffering servant to a king who doesn't suffer. You see, Satan was trying to change the identity of Jesus. He was trying to change who the Father said Jesus is. And every time Satan comes to tempt you, every time you come to the testing ground, God is proving that you are who he says you are. And Satan is coming to disprove, disqualify, and destroy who you are in God. Are you ready to win today? Our king defeated Satan. Be gone from me, Satan. He was done. And from that moment, Satan lost all of his ground. And there was nothing stopping Jesus from becoming the king who laid down his life to renew, remake, and restore our broken world. So how do we win today? How do we defeat the attacks of Satan? How do we pass this test? First of all, we need, in order to pass this test, to use the weapons that Jesus used in fighting Satan. Jesus was given two weapons at his baptism to defeat the devil. The first weapon Jesus was given at his baptism is the Holy Spirit. The Spirit descended upon Jesus. That's what John the Baptist testified, that the Spirit descended upon Jesus. Jesus was filled with the Spirit, Luke tells us. He was led by the Spirit and empowered by the Spirit of God. And because he lived a life being filled, led, and empowered by the Spirit, he lived a life that was pleasing to God. If Jesus needed the Holy Spirit, we need the Holy Spirit. If Jesus could not have conquered the devil without the Holy Spirit, then we absolutely cannot conquer the devil without being filled, led, and empowered by the Holy Spirit. In the church world today, the Holy Spirit in Trinitarian doctrine is like Cinderella who got left out of the party while the other two sisters went to the ball. Some theologians say he's the forgotten God. Not here at Southpoint, guys. We are not going to forget the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, we can do nothing. I can't follow Jesus. I can't do his commands. I can't live the life that God has called me to live. I can't pass the test unless I am filled with the Holy Spirit. That's why my brother wrote a paper about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We're putting up the QR code right now. And if you want to read this paper and you have never been baptized with the Holy Spirit, you need a little bit more information. You need to click on this piece of paper and you need to read the paper and come to Victory Day coming up in November and be free from the lies of the enemy keeping you from living a life filled, led, and empowered by the Holy Spirit. It's going to take you about an hour to read. It's about 20-something pages. But if you want doctrine and theology to clear up all the lies that the enemy has been dealing you about the Holy Spirit, you need to read this. God wants to fill you with his Holy Spirit. He wants you to lead a life that is led by the Holy Spirit and empowered by the Holy Spirit. Are you ready for power today? Are you ready for power to say no to sin? Jesus, because he was filled with the Spirit, was led by the Spirit. Matthew says in 4:1, Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Led by the Spirit into the wilderness. The wilderness here, the word is eremos. And eremos, we see, is the testing ground where God tests. It's where the enemy comes to tempt, where God tests. But it's more than that. We see the word eremos all throughout the Gospels. In Mark chapter 1, verse 35, it says, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus went to the eremos to pray. It says in Matthew 14:13 that after Jesus heard that John the Baptist was beheaded by Herod, Jesus went to the eremos to get alone, to be comforted by the Father. See, we often look as the wilderness. We'll say this as Christians. I'm in a wilderness season. Right? I'm in a wilderness season. God's not really speaking to me right now. Well, it's actually opposite in the Bible, guys. The eremos is where God spoke to Jesus. The eremos is where Jesus got away from the crowd, the distractions of life. He had been doing ministry into the deep nights, and he got into the eremos in the early morning because he was getting away to be with God, to find comfort in God, to find counsel from God. You see, the eremos is not just the testing ground of our spirituality. The eremos is the training ground of spiritual fitness. And Jesus was led by the Spirit, it says, into the eremos. That's where, if you stop the verse right there, the Holy Spirit led Jesus into the eremos, the place where Jesus went to pray, the place where Jesus went to be comforted, the place where Jesus went to get alone with the Father, away from the distractions of life. The Spirit led him into the eremos. To be trained for 40 days, to be trained for 40 days. Jesus ate no food and drank no water for 40 days straight. He fasted. He got into the Word of God. He got into prayer. He trained spiritually. He was spiritually fit from 40 days of training in the eremos. Every day, saying no to the desires of his physical hunger. You see, Jesus had no sin that he had to say no to in the eremos. But he did have a human body like our own, and he did get hungry just like us. And with no food and no water, several hundred times Jesus would have said, no, I'm not going to eat, I'm not going to drink. Even though my physical flesh desires this, I'm saying no. You know what we do when we fast? We say, not my will, but your will be done. Not my will, but your will be done. Not my will, but your will be done. Jesus said that over and over and over again in the wilderness. You see, the wilderness is the place where we get to say, not what I want, but you, what you want, God. So when Satan came to Jesus, Jesus had already said no to his physical desires hundreds of times. So when Satan said, take these stones and turn them into bread, oh, I've already said no hundreds of times. This is not a problem. Man shall not live by bread alone, but from every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. He took him up to the pinnacle of the temple. Oh, no, I don't have to do that. Because it says in Deuteronomy, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Takes him up to the high mountain because he had said no in the Aramos. Jesus said, no, I'm not going to bow down because it says, you shall fear the Lord your God only and bow down to him and serve him only. There is no other God to be worshipped except for Yahweh. You see, in the Oremos, the Holy Spirit is going to lead you. He's going to train you. Make sure that you let the Holy Spirit lead you into the Oremos before the tempter arrives. Don't get to the test and that be the first time that you are in the Oremos. The Holy Spirit wants to lead you in your quiet times. He wants to lead you in life groups. He wants to lead you in worship. He wants to lead you in the Word. The Holy Spirit is going to lead you over and over and over again. Let him lead you there to the depths that you could never have imagined that you could have gone in God. Let him lead you to places of prayer, places where you're on your knees, places where you're crying out with all of your heart, so that you can be ready for the test. Amen? The second weapon that Jesus was given at his baptism is the word of God. A voice from heaven said, this is my beloved son. A voice from heaven. God gave Jesus his word. Jesus quotes the word of God every single time Satan comes against him. And it should be noted that what Satan uses against Jesus is the word of God. Two of the three temptations is a direct quote from the scriptures. But Jesus quotes the scriptures every single time, all three times. And interestingly, this is not by coincidence. I love how God works. He quotes Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 8, Deuteronomy chapter 6, two times. 8:3, 6:16. In 6:13, he quotes to defend who God says he is. And the interesting thing about Deuteronomy, why does Jesus quote from Deuteronomy? Deuteronomy is the last book of the law of the books of Moses, of the Pentateuch. And it is the Deuteronomy, Deuteronomos, means the second giving of the law, the second law. And the first generation of Israel went to Mount Sinai, received the law, and then they failed in the wilderness. They all died in the wilderness, the fighting generation. So a new generation was raised up in the wilderness who had not heard the Ten Commandments, who had not heard the law of God. So Deuteronomy, this is so amazing, was the second giving of the law right before they entered the promised land. So what is Jesus doing? He's saying, you know, my people, they failed in the wilderness, but I'm not gonna fail. They failed to keep the commands of God, I won't. And because I haven't failed and I never will they will inherit the promises of God fully. All of the promises of God find their yes and amen in Jesus. I just have to wonder what the devil was thinking when he started bringing out Deuteronomy out of all the books in the Bible. What is he doing? Oh, no. This is the book that transitions Israel from wilderness to promised land. Jesus is defeating the devil by keeping the commands of God. So that the people of God, even though we are weak and stupid, foolish, ignorant, and rebellious, we can receive his righteousness and the commands that he obeyed as our own and inherit all the promises of God. God is good, isn't he? The second reason that he uses the book of Deuteronomy is because he teaches us how to properly use God's word. By using the scripture, Jesus teaches us three things about the word of God and how to use it. First, he teaches us that the word of God is only effective against sin and temptation if we use all of it. We must live off the entire word of God, not just some of it. Man shall not live by bread alone, but from every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. The word of God, partially used, is never effective. In fact, it is dangerous. Think about Satan. He used part of the word of God to manipulate and do the opposite of what God was doing with all of the word of God. Your Christianity is dangerous if you hold on to some of the scripture and not all of the scripture. It is dangerous for you. It is dangerous for your family. It is dangerous for the world that you're living in. You know how many people call themselves Christians and say, I'm going to live this kind of life because the scripture says I can live this kind of life because they took a part of the scripture instead of the whole scripture. Take the whole scripture because part of the scripture is what the devil's using. Use the entire word of God. Don't take out the pieces that you don't like. Thomas Jefferson has a Bible where he cut out all the miracles of Jesus. A deist who believes in a God who created the world but stepped away from the creation, and the world is just like operating like a clockmaker who made a clock and is letting that clock run. What kind of Christianity is that? A powerless and dead and uninvolved Christianity. Let God use the whole word of God. Some of us are not changing because we are taking part of the scriptures instead of the entire scriptures. Go all in. Jump into what God has called you to have. Let him transform your life. Let him have what you don't want him to have. He wants all of your life. And it takes all of the scriptures. Man, it's hot in this room right now. The sweat is coming through. I can see Jason. He's probably looking at me, making fun of me right now. He leaned over to me and he said, it's hot in here. Well, it's about to get hotter because I'm excited. The second thing that Jesus teaches us is that the word of God is only effective if we use it for God's glory and not our gain. Oh, how many times can we come to the scriptures and we read those scriptures and we build ourselves up, but we do it for our own gain instead of God's glory? God has called us to use his scriptures for his glory and not our gain. Think about the gain that Jesus could have had. He could have had a warm, fresh meal meeting his physical desires. He could have been a king whose servants are serving him. He could have not had the sufferings of laying down his life in order to come and save the world. He could have had it all for his gain, but God would not have been glorified. Jesus used the scriptures for God's glory, even when it meant taking away his gain. And Satan doesn't know what to do with a person who will use the scriptures for the glory of God, even when it means the loss of their gain. When Satan finds that kind of person, he doesn't know what to do. They are unstoppable in the test. Let God use you, use his scriptures to glorify him, even when that means you don't gain what you thought you would gain. Lastly, he teaches us that the word of God is effective when we actually obey it. You know, you could go into prayer sessions, come to church every Sunday, go to every life group. You could lead a life group. You could take people through the one-to-one, go through the one-to-one, go to Cross Track, go to Victory Day, and not even get close to passing the test. Because the word of God is only effective when it is actually obeyed. To learn the scriptures is head knowledge. Knowledge puffs up. Love builds up. And you know what love is? Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey my commands. You want your life to be built. You want your life to pass the test. Then practically, actually obey the scriptures. Actually start following what it's. I don't care how much you know of your Bible. I care how much you obey. That's God. How much are you obeying? Are you really obeying the scriptures? Are you listening to the scriptures? A lot of knowledge with a little versus a little bit of obedience will never hold up. A little bit of obedience with hardly any knowledge is far more than all the knowledge in the world and no obedience. Let's obey Jesus and his commands. Amen. The second thing we must do to overwhelmingly pass a test after using the weapons that Jesus uses is rest in Jesus' victory. Now, this is something important because a lot of times what we will think is, man, I got to go out and I'm going to fight. I'm going to prove myself. Are you going to prove yourself? Really? Are you going to prove him? Are you going to prove Jesus? You see, our propensity as humans is we have never passed the test. We are prideful, selfish, arrogant. When someone says, here's gain, we're like, oh, absolutely. We trade God's glory for our gain. We make it all about ourselves. The only way to really pass the test is first, what we have to do is to rest in Jesus' victory. Jesus' victory has to become your victory. And what I mean by that is when you come, you say, I'm not enough, Lord. I can't save myself. I can't defeat Satan. I'm not that proud. I'm not stronger than the devil, but Jesus is. And if you will live a life surrendered to Jesus, resting in his victory will become your victory. We have to surrender to our King. This fight is only won by humbly admitting we are not enough, that we cannot defeat sin, that we cannot defeat temptation, but Jesus did, and Jesus will help us as we rest in his victory. Are you resting in your own strength, in your own willpower, or are you resting in Jesus, in the victory that he has already won? As we close today, I want to leave you with this thought. When Jesus was tempted, the devil said, if you are the Son of God, if you are the Son of God, Do you know where that happens again? Go read Matthew 27 tonight. Jesus was on the cross. And as he was suffering on the cross, you know what the crowd said? You know what the soldiers said? You know what the Pharisees said? They said, if you are the Son of God, come off that cross. Come out of that place of suffering. If you are the Son of God, then call the myriads of angels to come and serve you, to come and rescue you. If you are the Son of God, then don't suffer anymore. You see, the wilderness in Matthew 4, Luke 4, Mark 1, the wilderness was a pre-battle for the real battle. It was a warm-up for what Jesus would do on the cross. And if Jesus would have given in to Satan in the wilderness, he would have never been able to die on the cross and stay on the cross in love, in obedience to the Father as a suffering servant. He stayed because he proved to the world, I'm the Son of God who pleases the Father. I'm the suffering servant who has all authority and all power, but I'm not going to use my authority and power in this moment to destroy you and to come off this cross. I'm going to stay true to who the Father says I am. And because I'm going to stay true to who the Father says I am, you are going to be able to become who the Father says you are and stay true to who the Father says you are. Are you ready to stop trusting in yourself and trust in the King who gave his life for you, who rose from the dead? Let's go ahead and bow our heads. Close your eyes. Jesus is before you today. A lot of you are going through tests, you're going through trials. But the first thing that we have to do is surrender to our Lord. We have to let him be our King. Instead of us trying to rule our lives, we have to rest in his rule and reign. If you say, Aaron, I want to surrender my life to Jesus. I want to give my life to Jesus. I want you to lift your hands right where you are, both hands. Just lift them up. Lift them up to the King. This is for you and Jesus. Hold those hands up. This is the beginning of your victory. This is the beginning of your breakthrough. Lord God, you see these hands. Lord, we lift these hands as an act of surrender to our King, as an act of surrender to our Lord. Jesus, be my Lord. I want all the believers and the people lifting up their hands, I want you to say this. Jesus, be my Lord. Be my King. I surrender to you today. I'm tired of trying to fight through the test on my own. I need the one who is victorious. I need the one who is mighty. I need the one who is great to lead me, the one who suffered for me. Jesus, help me to be who you died for me to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Southpoint Community Church, let's live a life surrendered to our Lord and our King. Let's live a life filled with the Spirit of God and obeying the Scriptures every day. And when the Lord tests us and the enemy comes to tempt us, let's win by proving who God has called us to be. Amen? Love you guys.
Praise God. Wasn't that an incredible word today from Pastor Aaron? Wow. Well, we are going to continue in the worship with our Sunday morning tithes and offerings. And so there's a couple ways that you can give here at Southpoint Community Church. There's three ways. One, you can text Southpoint CC to the number, I think it's 77977. We can do that. You will get an electronic link there on your mobile app. We have envelopes in the front that you can put cash or check. If you're writing a check, you can write it out to SCC, stands for Southpoint Community Church. Or you can get online on our app. We have it giving on our front page of our website app. Those of you that are watching online is also right there in the chat section. And I just want to say thank you so much for your faithfulness. We have an incredible, generous, faithful group of people here at Southpoint. And we just want to say thank you for that. And we know that because of your generosity, God's blessing you because his word says so. Amen. Amen. If you've already given electronically, maybe it's coming out automatic like me and my wife do, don't let this moment pass by. Let's worship God within this moment and ask him to bless this offering. So let's go ahead and pray. Father, I thank you so much for that incredible word. Lord God, we are so grateful that you are our Lord and Savior, that you are our God. The living God is our God. And Father, I pray right now, Lord God, that you would bless every giver. God, you would bless this offering to meet every need, that you would bless this offering to advance your kingdom. We give this offering so that you would be glorified, not us, Lord God. So, Father, bless it, Lord. Bless every giver. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, we also have something called the Connect Card here at Southpoint Community Church. If I can get everyone to pull out that card. If you are new here to Southpoint, first of all, welcome to Southpoint. We're so glad you are our guest here. We would love for you to give us as much information as you are comfortable with. We use this to connect you to the life here at Southpoint Community Church. We have an amazing spiritual family, and we want to help you take that next step to get connected to that. The best next step is on the bottom there, is Grow Track. Grow Track happens the first four Sundays of every month, happening right after service today. Just go out the doors, turn to the right, go up the stairs, and we'll probably be about 20, 30 minutes right after service. And Grow Track is kind of where you hear all about the next steps here at Southpoint. You want to learn about our history, how you can grow in your relationship with Christ, how you can get connected to our life groups and serving. It's really the jump-off point of everything SEC. So we would love for you to spend a little bit more time with us this Sunday. I know the weather's amazing, but it's going to be amazing after Grow Track as well. Amen? And so go to Grow Track, stop in there, and spend a few more minutes with us. Just take this card. If you raised your hand and you surrendered your life to Christ today, please mark it on this Connect card and drop this Connect card in the black box with your offering envelopes as you are leaving. Well, you guys noticed that when the storm came through, the weather started changing a little bit. I mean, we're down in the 60s in the morning. Fall is coming, amen? Fall is coming. We cannot wait. And that means our fall-a-days are coming as well. So we have a few things coming up at the end of this month. Number one, our trunk or treat is happening on 31st. It's going to be amazing time there. Also, the next Sunday is our Fall-A-Days Sunday Carnival Sunday, where after service, we all go out in the back and hang out and have an amazing time. And it's going to be an incredible opportunity for us. So there's a few things that we want to show you how you can be involved. Because we are hoping on both of those days that you bring so many people who don't know Jesus to our church and they end up getting saved. So this is how you can get involved. There's three ways that you can get involved that should come up on the screen behind me. First, we every day start praying through our ASK, A-S-K, prayer guide. So we have put the ASK prayer guide on our app and the front page of our website. Starting tomorrow, we would love for you to every single day run through that prayer guide and now and there. Now, that's going to get our hearts ready. Going to get our hearts ready to talk to someone about Jesus. We need to pray our way to where our heart is like his heart, to where we want the lost people to be saved. It's for God to soften our hearts. So pray the ask prayer guide every day. Also, those two events are incredible events. So it takes an army, amen? It takes an army to serve those people. And so we have a Fall-A-Days serving card in every seat as well. We need your trunks, right? We want to line the palm trees on Trunk or Treat with 40 to 50 trunks, and we need yours. So if you're interested in doing that, fill this out. Let us know that. There's also unbelievable other server opportunities with games and the blow-ups the next Sunday as well. We would love for you to sign up for both of them. do a trunk on trunk or treat, then come help us on one during after one of the services on the next Sunday for Fall Day. So all the information's right there on that card. You can also get to this electronically if you go to our event page and click on either trunk or treat or Fall Day Sunday there on our event pages. You can do that electronically as well. But the easiest way to go ahead and let us know right now today, if you are interested, we will follow up with you with details. And then the third thing that we want you to do to get involved is to go invite your neighbors, your friends, coworkers to come to you to trunk or treat, because we believe if they come to you with a trunk or treat, we're going to invite them to come back to church with you on that next Sunday, and they're going to get saved. Amen. So we have seed cards in your seat as well. Please take these. Go give these to people that you know or are acquainted with, no matter who they are. Invite them not only just to come, invite them to come with you, right? Come with me. Come and see. Amen. So there are the three ways. Get involved in that. We are so excited about what God is going to do here at the end of this month. Also, men, don't forget this Sunday is men night. We need you to sign up so we know about food. So if you've been postponing it, I'm asking you to stop. Sign up today. Amen. Do it right now on your phones. You can get on the events page. Get that done so we'll know if you're coming so we can make sure we got enough food for you to eat, because you know how we eat at men night. We eat good. Amen. Amen. And also, if you are in the winning in your finances class, we postponed it for last week, but we are doing week two this Wednesday night, all right? So we just shifted to 2 weeks over 2 weeks. So week two is going to be this Wednesday night. Make sure if you need childcare, it's free, but you still need to let us know that you need it every week. Go online, sign up for that. It's going to be amazing how God is going to bless you and to help you win in your finances. Go ahead and take a stand. Let me pray a blessing over you to go out into this amazing day. The weather's amazing, and the opportunity is amazing for you to show someone about Jesus. Amen. Raise your hand. Father, thank you so much for that incredible word, Lord. That crazy, amazing word that you spoke, Father. I pray in the name of Jesus that we would go full of your Spirit. God, we would be like our Lord and Savior Jesus and obey the whole word of God, that we would show you and prove who you are as we go out and live this life this week, Lord God, that we would give you all the glory and not ourselves, that people would come into the kingdom because of how they live. Bless them, pour out your Spirit on them until they come back together as family to worship you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. You guys are incredible. We'll see you soon.